That. Okay.
New lady. Are you ready to start the webinar?
Yes, we're ready to start. Thank you.
Keisha, we could pick up some of that conversation you were talking about, but before you came on, Lisa and I were talking about a lot of the changes in that building because they've happened. They're in where Lisa is too. I mean, Lisa is part of the change too there, but in particular, there was a lot going on where in the random crown, Hogarth, all those pieces and parts, but yeah.
Absolutely.
So we're just waiting a minute here as folks get logged in. So, but we are live and excited to host Keisha Bush and Lisa Lucas to talk about No Heaven for Good Boys. And folks are just logging in here. We'll give it maybe one more second. Everybody can hear all of the behind the scenes publishing gossip. We'll get into it later. Right.
Absolutely.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, it looks like our attendance numbers have stabilized, so I'm going to go ahead and get started, and folks will continue to join us as we proceed. So, good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders, past and present, and thank them for the stewardship of this land. Welcome to our event with Keisha Bush and Lisa Lucas, presented in partnership with Wanawari and Elliott Bay Book Company. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company have copies of Keisha's book, No Heaven for Good Boys. They're open for limited browsing, curbside pickup, and delivery. You can find the book at their website, elliottbaybook.com, and we'll also pop a link in the chat so you can just copy and paste right from that. After tonight's conversation, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And finally, we'd love to hear from you. Toward the end of the program, we'll post a link to a survey in the chat, and we'd appreciate it if you took a few minutes afterwards to share your thoughts with us. Now, I am delighted to welcome Rick Simonson from Elliott Bay Book Company, who will introduce tonight's program. Hi, Rick.
Natasha, and good evening, everybody. And actually, I want to say a little bit because the way, for those of you who have been to the Seattle Library for when programs there have been and will again someday, we hope, be live again, and we've done these kind of evenings, you would, when we've been there, you don't get statements about the audience numbers stabilizing because it's sort of apparent that people are coming in or not coming in. But you also get announcements about the restrooms and the library itself closing at what time it closes. So, but otherwise, there's this sense of the people who are there. And those of you who've joined us, we're grateful that you're with us tonight. We're delighted to be involved with this program for Keisha Bush's debut book, No Heaven for Good Boys, a novel that whose coming into being is probably a story of its own. And I don't even begin to know all of it, but it's any book that first book that's come out during the pandemic, there's a story to it and for it. Some books found their places easily, and others it's been a different story. But the story is the story, and the one that for us, Keisha and this book coming to our attention for all the ways that there's back and forth with people in New York or wherever else, was a friend of Keisha's who is a friend of my colleague Karen's, and the friend wrote, "I have this friend that's written a wonderful book." And sometimes you get those kind of messages, and you have to kind of keep a little bit wary eye because not all those books are so wonderful. But then we realized what book it was, and the book had come in and had been in our hands. This book, No Heaven for Good Boys, and but it also helped draw attention to actually, to some of us reading it. This is a book that is unlike most first novels, which, not to paint it too broadly, almost typical for his novel, has some story from an author's family or background or you know, something. This is a book set in mostly in the city of Dakar, the capital of Senegal, there and in a particular village in the south of Senegal. And it's the story of two young boys in particular and other boys and much else. I'm not going to get into this too much because that's really what you will get to hear from tonight. But it is a remarkable book. And what she's done, Keisha Bush has done in this book is tell a story that does not feel like it's been told by someone from outside of that place, even though she is not of or from Dakar or Senegal. She did live there for a number of years in another life doing business work. And it's there's some notes even in the book about how she was drawn to this story and to the continued livelihood and existence of the boys that she writes, the kinds of boys that she writes about who are very much part of a kind of urban situation there in Dakar and probably other cities. So tonight, Keisha will discuss and perhaps read a little bit from this book. And quite delightfully, she's in conversation with our friend Lisa Lucas, known to many of us initially in the book world for as being editor of Guernica. In fact, when I first met her, I think in remember meeting her in Seattle. She was an editor at Guernica when big conference was in Seattle. She has since quite notably been the head, the director of the National Book Foundation, an esteemed and valuable organization, which continues to do esteemed and valuable work, but she actually has transformed that organization for the better, not only the whole basis of the National Book Awards, which is what the National Book Foundation is probably most known for, but she's actually changed the substance of that even for the better. There's a translation award. But she's also charged the work of the foundation, which is to really get reading and make reading happen and to hands of readers all over the country, all different classes, all different backgrounds, and out all over the country, not just in New York where the organization is based. And she's done a marvelous transformative job of that. She's now coming to us as the new publisher of Pantheon Books and just getting going in another field, which also has a great history, but also is in good use and need of transformation. So the two of them you will be in great company. Please do put questions in the chat and the Q&A, and Lisa, I believe, will handle those, and Stesha will come back at the end to bid everyone good night. And there is, I think there'll be some more postings in the chat about getting copies of No Heaven for Good Boys. We of course love it if you get it from Elliott Bay. We ship books all over, but if you're somewhere else and you have a good independent store, do support that store, and do also support this book. This is a really remarkable book, and as a debut, it's even more vital to help draw attention to Keisha Bush and whatever work comes next, which we hope will happen. So on that note and basis, thank you all for joining us on behalf of the Seattle Public Library Foundation, Juana Wari, and Elliott Bay Book Company. And now you're in the good hands of Keisha Bush and Lisa Lucas. Take it away.
All right. Thanks so much for being here today, Keisha. I'm super excited to talk to you about the book and how it came to be born, and just to remind everybody to absolutely buy it. From Elliott Bay or your local indie, as Rick said. Thanks so much for that wonderful introduction. So I would love for you to read at some point, but let's just start a little bit and just talk about this story. So you're talking, you know, we immediately enter this world that's so clearly in Senegal, and you are not from Senegal, correct?
No.
Right? No. How did you come to write the story of these boys in a country that you're not from, you know, with such grace and sort of ease, because it's a debut and it's not the least ambitious thing anybody's ever done. So tell me a little bit about the origin point of this story and how you came to know this place and these young people.
Okay. In 2004, it sort of started somewhere around 2003, but in 2004, I decided to get away from the Americas. Like I wanted to travel and live somewhere else. And I found a volunteer program that brought me to West Africa. And I was first based in Gambia, but after about a month and a half, 2 months, I was like, I'm out of here. And I went to Dakar and I called up a Senegalese friend of mine in New York. And I said, hey, do you have any family in Dakar? Because I knew no one. And he was just like, yeah, my mom is there. And I'm like, can I stay with her? So he asked her, got back to me. She said yes. And I ended up staying with his family. And one of his sisters had just returned from New York. And they went to school here. So I basically had a friend who spoke fluent English, knew like the US and New York, but was from Senegal. And those tended to be like my better friends. You know, the friendships were really easy. And I started teaching English and then worked on my French so that I could get a job, because you needed to be fluent enough in French. My French sucks now, but give me a little time. And when I was sort of walking around Dakar, I kept seeing these kids in the street. And you know, you see people begging and you see homeless people, but these kids were like barefoot, old dirty t-shirt on, and they were all begging for money, and there were clusters of them all through the city. And you know, in hindsight, I learned that there is up to 100,000 kids like this. But after I started asking around, I discovered that they weren't orphans, they had families, that their families in some cases, in many cases, didn't even know that they were being forced to beg. They were supposed to be at this school of the Quran called Adara, and begging for maybe 2 hours a day to learn humility and help their teacher out. But instead these kids were like begging 12 to 16 hours a day. And it was just, it was very crushing. And I like kids. I have like 5 younger siblings. So I was always surrounded by little ones. And I saw my siblings and even myself in these little boys. From the ages of about 3 years old to 13 is really what I saw. And I wanted to start a nonprofit, and I did start a company to sort of work with them, but then realized to be able to have any impact, I would have to dedicate like the next 10 years of my life living there. Mm-hmm. And I actually, which I think is the funniest joke, I miss America. Mm-hmm. Now I'm like over it again. I'm ready to go. But oh, yeah. You know, it really does happen.
Changes every day. Yeah.
So I missed home, and I missed my family and my friends. And I came back in 2008 and still wasn't ever thinking about being a writer. And I was working at this nonprofit in the village, in the city. And it was just like so toxic. It was just horrible. But I enjoyed my work, but it was horrible. The workspace. And I just had, I had like a, you know, is this really the rest of my life moment? And I started writing. And in 2010, this story, the family really, and the boys came back to me. I think they were always in my heart. And I realize over time, like I've worked with several different writers, you know, like John Reed and Luis Aramillo, and I went back to grad school and got my MFA and really entrenched myself in this world of like, I'm going to be a full-time writer, you know, taking this as a career change. And I was always an avid reader, and I read everything, all genres. But I was, like one of the things that I was very focused on when I went back to school was to improve my skill set, like my technique as a writer, community and mentorship. And I do a lot of things like my characters are fictional, but the scaffolding of the story, so No Heaven for Good Boys, the scaffolding itself is all nonfiction for the most part. You know, you can
tell me a little bit more about the nonfiction scaffolding. So how did you?
Yeah. So I took 4 years of me living in Senegal, West Africa, and I condensed it into the year that happens in the book. Mm-hmm. So Dakar itself becomes this character in the book, and I have the fictional characters react to that nonfiction timeline mm-hmm. that I condensed. So for example, the zoo really exists, and that's the name of the zoo. Mm-hmm. And let's see, Magic Land. I actually took my writing students, or my English students actually, to Magic Land, which is like the only amusement park. You don't see any Talibate inside because it is too expensive for them to get there. Mm-hmm. There is, Mamel, the hill mm-hmm. where there's a lighthouse and there's doctors there that will fix the feet of any Talibate. Right. True.
So you were really researching the context in which these boys inhabit and these families inhabit, you know, over the time that you were living there. So, but you know, but it's like, it seems to me, you know, like it would be really hard to get to know the sort of inner thoughts and feelings of a six-year-old boy, you know, from another country that speaks a different language that you're not fluent in, right? So how do you go about figuring out how to, you know, really understand the interiority there, how to sort of think about the feelings, the desires, how much a Coca-Cola matters, how much, you know, the driving impulses for a young person who doesn't really understand and who's only starting to have any sense of what's really happening around them.
Yeah. I remember when I realized in my writing workshops, one of my strengths that I learned.
And actually, wait, I'm going to stop you. I'm so sorry. Let's back it up before you answer that question, because I do want to talk about the characters and you know, how you got there. But can you talk a little bit of the frame of the story? I know you talked a little bit about encountering these young boys and realizing, but can you just talk about just broad strokes, you know, the story that you're telling here?
So the initial draft, I was really upset that these children are living a human rights crisis and they're so young. And it's based off of, it's using religion mm-hmm. as a shield from criticism, right? So these daras, the school that these children are sent to is to learn the Quran. Mm-hmm. And children who are, their minds are malleable. So their focus is to memorize the Quran, and it takes 3 to 5 years generally to do. Mm-hmm. And Talibay is sort of like a brotherhood, or even you can sort of see it as a monkhood, mm-hmm. right?
So why are the parents sending their little boys here? Like, is it, you know, are yeah. they aware? Are they not?
It has to, so it's a really old tradition, and it's really about like being a good Muslim, being a dedicated, you know, Muslim to Allah, and having your children, having your boys memorize the Quran is actually a sense of esteem.
Sure.
Right? Now, wealthy middle-class families, a teacher will go and visit their house and teach the Quran maybe once a week right. for 2 hours. And then the family donates money. Poor kids have to go to a school of the Quran. And if a village doesn't have a school, then you'll send your kids off. Mm-hmm. And the parents are poor, so they can't pay to send their kids. And these teachers are like, I'll take your kids, I'll take care of them. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that the children do is they go out and beg to collect alms mm-hmm. to help the teacher run the school, except that they're not getting taught much, if anything. And they're forced to beg 16 hours a day because they have to fill a quota. And that was the thing that really got me when I learned about it from my friends in Dakar, mm-hmm. that these kids have to raise like a dollar a day, the equivalent. And if you know, all of the readings and all of the studies we hear about, you know, the developing world, oh, this family is only living on a dollar a day or $2 a day, right? Because it's really hard when you're poor to raise that much money. How are you telling a five-year-old that he needs to raise that dollar, feed himself, but he can't use the money to feed himself, so he has to also beg for his own food, and if he doesn't bring it back, he's beat or chained like dogs, and there's like all kinds of mass abuse. Mm-hmm. So my initial was like, okay, I'm not going to run a nonprofit because I want to be home. I'm going to write this book.
Right.
And this book will bring and hopefully raise awareness. And that's how I give back to the children.
Yeah. And this is where we meet Etienne and Ibrahima.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So, you know, so these two boys, tell me about them a little bit. Tell me about, you know, the fictional young boys that are in this school with Marabou, who's terrible and punitive, and how we sort of enter this world.
It was in a revision that I added chapter one. Mm-hmm. So 2016, chapter one came into the story, even though I wrote the first draft in 2010, because I had always wanted to send them to the zoo, mm-hmm. and I didn't know how to fit it in the actual narrative, but it worked perfectly as the opening chapter, you know, to sort of show their childhood wonderment, especially with seeing animals that they've never seen before. Mm-hmm. I actually watched like hours of YouTube videos of Dakar Zoo that didn't exist when I lived in Dakar, but like with technology exists sure. now. And
even like we exist for everyone watching.
Exactly. As in like the pandemic in 1918 really didn't have that. They're at a loss. Spanish flu. Ibrahima and Etienne are my heart. Mm-hmm. I love the two of them so much. Like they're my own children, and I don't have children, but if I did, they would be Ibrahima and Etienne. And they, for me, represent the innocence and the sweetness that I saw amongst hundreds. Because I'm just saying hundreds in like my experience. So I don't know if I've seen thousands of Tally Bay or interacted, but I know I've experienced and interacted with at least a couple of hundred Tally Bay. Mm-hmm. And they sort of, Ibrahim and Etienne sort of summed them up. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember there was a really busy intersection in Dakar, and all these Tally Bay are just like, it's just mad. They're like running, trying to make money, in and out of cars. And I had extra money on me, and you know, I went and asked them in a mix of French and Wolof, hey, you hungry? I'll buy you some food. And they said, yes, of course, they always say yes. And there was a little one, he was only three. And as we were crossing the street, I just like put my hand down and he grabbed it. Oh. Like it was just natural for the two of us. Like you're a baby. And I know like after I crossed him across that busy intersection, bought food and left, that he was still on his own. Mm. But it just went to show, or like I was their banana girl,
right?
You know, so I would buy them bananas. When they would see me, they come running asking for the bananas. And I remember one time I had a whole bunch of bananas, and they lined themselves up and they put the littlest ones first. And then some women came over to beg with like a child on her hip, and they like, no, 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 the woman goes first. And I'm like, you all are like eight, mm-hmm. you know, like, but you have this heart to you. And so I'll give you an example. One of the things that I did with some of the characters, Etienne is like in a fatherly big brother role to Ibrahima, and he helps Ibrahima. And this is because Etienne has been a Tally Bay for 5 years already when Ibrahima becomes a Tally Bay. Mm-hmm. He's sent to Dakar. And I have a friend that I met when I was living in Senegal, and his name is Etienne. And he grew up in the States, but was back home for his reasons and married. And when I was developing the characters, one of the things that I did is like, Etienne, my character, has the heart of Etienne, my friend, whom right. I love. And so like when Etienne, the character, grows up, I imagine him being such a good man like my friend Etienne. Mm-hmm. And that's how developing the children was for me.
Right.
You know, to sort of give them this depth.
Does your friend have similar experiences as a young man?
No.
Okay.
He had his own struggle.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
That caught my heart, but he was never a Tally Bay.
So how do you balance, like, you know, so it's like one of those things where, you know, you travel to so many different countries, you see young people and you don't have any sense of what their lives are like, right? You know, it's like some tourists consider them to be nuisances. Some people, their hearts break. Mm-hmm. You know, some people are just absolutely, you know, sort of perplexed by the fact that this could possibly exist because it's so different from what you might see in New York City if you're in Midtown, right? But how do you try to grapple your understanding emotionally of what it must be like to be one of these young boys with the sort of reality, like this sort of like imposition of a Western, you know, sort of understanding of what it must be like for a child? Because it's you know, you're writing outside of your own experience.
Yeah.
And so how do you balance, you know, what you might imagine? And so right, your friend Etienne may have had different experiences and you're projecting him onto this young boy, but how do you also then come back to sort of the reality, the nonfiction side, the sort of nonprofit, sort of trying to raise awareness of an issue? How do you balance the imaginary and the really important truth, you know, of these boys' stories? Does that make sense?
It does make sense. So what you're asking, when I wrote that first draft in 2010, and I haven't mentioned in 2011, when I started taking continuing ed classes at the new school, I rewrote the book from scratch. Mm-hmm. And what I wanted to do was tell an authentic story. But what I realized around that time was that I had to do personal inner work to tell this story. And that first draft in 2010, I was avoiding my own experiences as a child and coming from poverty and my experiences with abuse and different trauma. And so I had to grapple with that to even be able to go there with these kids. And when I was writing these early draft, if you Google the Taliban now, you can find journalism on them. But back in 08, 2010, there was none at all. And the nonprofits that exist now, the work of Human Rights Watch, I think in 09, it was just starting, but they hadn't even, there were no white papers or any research being published about them. So I was kind of in the dark, going off of what I saw and then what I imagined. But I remember that there was this big New York Times article in 2011 about the Taliban. And it confirmed some of the things that I knew and or imagined. And that is why it was really hard. I think it would have been really hard to just write this book just with the Taliban experience. Mm-hmm. And that's why his mother has such a strong voice in the story, because the idea of taking a child from his mother is one that we know just as Black people and slavery and the family being torn apart. Or we can see migrants, I mean, at this point, migrants being separated from their children. Mm-hmm. But that has been in the narrative of humanity, of humans for a really long time. And so telling her story, I read this, it was like something I found on the internet, it's like a blog years ago about a Taliban that returned home to his mom and the father wouldn't accept him because it was, like pride and whatever, you know?
Sure.
And the aunt in the village accepted the son, this Taliban, to live with her. And she lived like right next door.
Right.
And after the father agreed that he can live with the aunt, so therefore he doesn't have to stay with his marabou, the mother finally spoke up and she was like, yeah, I really didn't want to send my son back. Right. But I had to do what my husband said. Mm-hmm. And so that gave me the sort of seed for Maimuna to say, I'm not going to put up with this. And Maimuna is purposely not Senegalese. She's Guinea. She's from Guinea. Mm-hmm. So being from Guinea, she's African, but she's still an outsider. Mm-hmm. And so she has a little more room not to conform in a way that someone might say, well, no, Senegalese women, this is what they do. Well, she's from Guinea. All right. And she's going to use that. And she's like, this is not okay. And I'm going to, you know. So it was all these little sort of these little things that actually makes such a bigger impact in the narrative and allow it to flow in an authentic way. Mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And so back to these marabous, can you explain who are they? Like, why, like, how does one become that person? Okay. And, you know, how do you try to draw out, you know, that part of it? Because it's really dark.
Yeah.
You know?
It is. Marabou is literally my least favorite character. Mm-hmm. And I actually gave him a little bit of myself so that he can exist in the book. Mm-hmm. I give him my love of numbers. I'm a big person. I do a lot of budgeting.
Fair enough.
And at one point he's
like, nonprofit life.
Exactly. Marabous in Senegal hold the power of a pope. So the people follow the pope in Catholicism, mm-hmm. and the pope is between the people and God. Mm-hmm. And in Senegal, marabous, you don't have just one marabou, you have many different marabous. And basically,
and I don't mean to sort of articulate that the entire idea is dark, but that the examination that we're doing here with the young boys kind of ending up begging and is dark. So
it is really dark. And basically what some of these marabous, there are good marabous, but there are more bad marabous than good marabous at this point, because it's become an opportunity to make money. Mm-hmm. I sort of see it as like when we first got some Uber drivers, it was cool. And now like the traffic is ridiculous. Like there are way too many Uber drivers possibly, right? In New York City. And what you have are men who are struggling to make money for their families in the village. And so they go to the city and, or they're already based in the city and they just start collecting kids, collecting boys. And, you know, they might do prayer, maybe an hour of some kind of Quran, whatever, but the kids are, they do have to raise a quota, and it's wicked in my opinion. Like this is wickedness because this is child slavery. And it became an international human rights crisis when Senegalese people started to get wind mm-hmm. of how abused their kids are. And that kind of pops up in the book a little bit.
Right. Yeah.
And they stopped sending their kids. And so when I was in Senegal, they were stopping. Some people were not sending their kids. And so these marabouts started to go into Mali and Guinea and Burkina Faso and bring kids from over there. And that became an international human rights crisis because they were crossing borders now. Mm-hmm. And the US in 2011, during the Obama days, passed some stipulations on money aid that they were giving Senegal. And one of the things that was dependent on that aid was that they needed to stop this human rights crisis, this child trafficking. Mm-hmm. And they rounded up around 2011, they rounded up some marabouts and made show of it. And I was like, man, by the time my book comes out, Taliban are gonna be like chilling, they're gonna be free. Yeah. And as per usual, capitalism and those in power find ways around it. And they just continued on, and the marabouts are not. So you have these laws that are there now in the country, but they're not being enforced in the way that they need to stop what's happening.
Have you had Senegalese friends read the book?
Yeah.
And what's been the reaction from
I had one friend who was just like, Keisha, we need more books like this. He's like, I see myself. I was like, yes. One reader, so my team at Random House, my editors, mm-hmm. there's this, I guess, new thing where it's like you send it out for authenticity, so you get authenticity readers. Mm-hmm. And one of my readers is a Senegalese man, young man, mm-hmm. and he sent me the most kindest email note. And he was just like, he read the book twice. And just, I've had other Senegalese people say, like, it is about time that someone wrote a book about the kids. And I think it's because this generation grew up seeing their peers. Because yes, the Talibay come from poor families, but they look like everyone else in the country. Mm-hmm. So you have young people not understanding why these other kids who look like them are being treated this way. But it's complicated because it's tied into religion and tradition. And I feel like as an outsider, when you're writing the other, it's super vital and it's super important that to check your own biases along the way.
Totally. Now, I mean, as a Black person, right, we're used to being written about to be, you know, it's like to be the other, right? Yeah. Somebody else writing about us. So yeah. What does that mean for you? You know, I mean, it's like you just mentioned an authenticity read, and what were you worried about? Like what scared you about writing from somebody else's perspective, and what do you think that you did, and what do you feel like, you know, do you feel like you hit the mark in the ways that you wanted to? Because it's obviously a debut, so you're gonna keep writing.
Yes, exactly. I was stressed the entire time. So years ago, I think it was before the revision, I had one of my girlfriends from West Africa read it. And she liked it, but she didn't like Maimuna. And she felt like I over-explained Maimuna in the book. And she was just like, look, girl. And I was like, but it's American readers. And she was like, they're smart enough. And I was like, all right, cool. You know what? I'm listening, you know? And that's how Maimuna became who Maimuna is today in the book. Mm-hmm. And what I ended up doing, the first draft, my reader was an American, who oftentimes is defaulted as white. Mm-hmm. And in my revision, my reader was a Talibé. Mm-hmm. This is how I feel like I checked myself.
Right.
I wanted Talibé to learn English, or when the French version comes out, mm-hmm. you know, to read it and see that someone loved him. And then turn around and realize that he can write his own story, that there's enough space in the world, mm-hmm. readers. And I think when my reader became the people that I was writing about, that made me hyper vigilant along the way, not to caricaturize them, not to write these flat characters. I think I loved living in Senegal too, you mm-hmm. know, West Africa. And so I see the book also sort of as this kind of like a love letter to the Talibé and Dakar, mm-hmm. and the complexities of tradition. I saw like my Senegalese friends who had grown up in the US and they were back home for various reasons. I saw them struggle with tradition, their families expecting them to just fall in line. And it was just like, dude, I've been living in the US for like 15 years, you know? I'm not that same person again. And I saw both my male friends and my female friends struggle to the point I felt so lucky to be the other. I was like, I am not beholden to any of these traditions. I'm just the American, Black American chilling here. It's all great. And so in the book, I try to show that in an unbiased way, how all these characters are just grappling with these things that sometimes are outside of their control. Mm-hmm. And I'm for community and tradition, but I'm also for individualism and individual voice and freedom. And like, where is the balance in that, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, just to go back to this sort of idea of sort of whose story is whose to tell.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that it's so interesting, right? Because I'm so used to, you know, the conversation around white writers writing about foreign experiences or people of color here domestically. Yeah. And, you know, just for you as a Black woman to be writing about something other, you know, what, you know, did you face any obstacles towards being able to tell or sell this story?
Mm, No. There's an interview, I think a Paris Review interview of Maya Angelou. Mm-hmm. I think it's Maya, not Tony. And at one point, the interviewer asks Maya about her opinion about white people writing the other, you know, white people writing about Black people in America. Mm-hmm. And I read this really early on, you know, as I was like working on this. And her answer was just so, I was like, Her answer was just like, she was like, I'm not against people writing the other. Mm-hmm. She was like, but you need to get it right. Mm-hmm. She's like, as a Black person, Black people grow up in an environment, in a country where any move could be your step to death. You mm-hmm. could die. Your family could die, right? And so Black people have always had to watch and study mm-hmm. white America,
right?
How to be around them, how to speak, you know, you don't want to get them too mad, don't want to get them too pissed off, whatever. And white people, part of the privilege of being white is you never have to study Black folks at all. Right. So it's not that, and so what I took from that is, it's not that people are unable to write the other, but it's when you don't know anything about the other than assumptions and stereotypes from mainstream media, then you're gonna always get it wrong.
Right.
And I felt like when I was living in Senegal, I had this really uncanny position where Black Americans are not as abundant as white or white Westerners in Africa. Mm-hmm. And so my neighbors and Senegalese people actually were really interested in me and learning mm-hmm. about me and about learning about Black America. And I was super interested in them. Like, this was the first time I was ever in Africa. You know, I was just like, tell me everything. You know? Just like, just soaking it in. And sure. there's just sort of like this really honest space of trust and this mutual exchange. And there's a section at one point that Maimuna refers to like American TV. Mm-hmm. And it's because I learned from my neighbor that Dallas, back in the day when Dallas was huge, really? Dallas is huge. My friends show me pictures of their parents in the 60s and 70s. I thought I was looking at pictures in Harlem, not in Senegal. They had their fro and their bell bottoms, little flower shirt, little button down. I was just like, so, you know, like there's this cultural connection that we don't even realize exists from there to here. Mm-hmm. And I think when I was writing this, I was trying to show how global Africa and Senegalese people are.
Right.
That they're actually not the other. We're othering them and they're not actually the other. Although their culture is in some ways different, or maybe their religion might be different. There's this like cultural, we have these cultural like similarities and understandings and desires.
Yeah.
You know, to be loved and to be seen and to be heard and to have family and to have opportunity, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I think I was constantly trying to like bring that thread to share that and to show that within the characters.
Absolutely. So you know what we forgot to do?
What?
We forgot to have you read a little bit of the book.
Oh.
Shall we pass it? There's a few questions, so we can just move to some Q&A, because I also should give everybody opportunity. And this is your moment, everybody. There's a couple of questions in the Q&A box, but if you have questions for Keisha, I would love to see them now. I can certainly ask her plenty more. But it's up to you. I didn't mean to put you on the spot. I just forgot to do it up top. So that was my bad. You can feel free to say no thank you, ma'am. Because everybody who's watching is obviously going to be purchasing a copy of the book from Elliott Bay Bookstore or their local indie. So it's like you will get a chance to read the beautiful writing. So instead, I'm going to ask Paulette Kennedy's question, which is, which character was your favorite to write and why?
Madame Torre. So Madame Torre is not, she is so minor. She's a minor character in the book, but she's one of the like best, she's like a really good friend of Maimuna and kind of like her best friend in the village. And I love I love Madame Torre because she doesn't take anyone's crap. And she's just like that sort of ride or die friend. And, you know, she protects and looks out for Maimuna even when Maimuna is not there to see it, you know, in different ways. Etienne, it's really hard. Etienne, I'll be honest, in the first draft, Etienne took over the story, you know, and when you read the book and you know Etienne, you can see how he can win you over,
right?
You know, just so amazingly. I don't really have favorite characters. I have my favorites. And then my other favorites are the three sisters. And they sort of exist as this pod of
the- You have five favorites, is what you're saying.
Yes, I have five favorites. And then my least favorite is Marabou. Like,
right, sure.
I really don't like that dude.
But is it fun to write a character that you don't like? Or is it hard?
It was kind of, I mean, you know what? Do you feel
steeped in the ugliness? Do you feel like it's kind of fun to write somebody wicked? Like, what's the...
No, I didn't enjoy him at all. And I constantly...
I mean, this is a pretty dark way to write something wicked, so probably not.
Yeah. No, I can see someone really enjoying it because you get to write this altar, you know? I think I was insecure about him always because I was just like, is it enough? Like, you know, not that is he wicked enough, but is he enough of a character that he doesn't just become this flat, wicked dude?
Right.
And at one point, like back in my workshop classes, somebody asked, like, why don't I dive deeper into his psychology? And I was like, why don't you do that? Yeah. I'm like, we already have the book Psycho, dude. We don't need, like, there are books out there that can dive deep into the psychology of like a wicked person. I'm just like that. I wasn't interested in that. There's some things that I'm just not interested in.
Fair enough. So to that end, how do you, another anonymous question asker says, you know, how did you emotionally work through writing the characters going through such difficult experiences? And did you feel a loss / miss the boys after the book was done? And I'm guessing yes, since you referred to them as like your child, your like emotional children earlier. So I'm assuming you miss them. But
yeah,
you know, but was it emotional writing the experiences of the Taliba? Was it you know, I'm trying to sort of project out what it might like feel like for a 6-year-old boy to be going through this?
Yeah. I initially felt immense guilt. Mm-hmm. So when I was in Senegal, I would buy them food, jelly sandals, burgers, you know, whatever, pizza, Coca-Cola. They love Coca-Cola. And when I was writing it, I realized that I wish I had given them money more often so that they could meet their quota and not get beat that night. And I felt a lot of guilt and had to grapple with all of that. The lucky thing for me is...
Why do you think that you're like just in that moment you decided to go, you know, is that an American disposition? I'm just curious, just even because it sort of probably says a lot about many people, not just you.
So I actually got the idea from an American. You know, some of my American friends, like, I don't support the Marabou, so I only give them food. And I was like, well, that's a way to sort of like push back against what these Marabous are doing while still helping the boys. But then as I was writing the book and realizing, and then even as more, you know, journalism has come out, the boys are at a point where some boys are even forced to raise $5 a day at this point. We're talking about 10 years later now. So my guilt at realizing that I could have alleviated some sort of pain further, more pain for them, really sat heavy on me for a long time. I felt like shame around it.
Right.
because I felt like it was such a privileged sort of decision. And there were times that I did give money. I just didn't give all the time.
No, sure, sure, sure. And I'm not asking in a judgmental way. I'm asking in a
I know. Clearly, I'm still struggling.
Not like, confess. Confess. No, yeah. Just by trying to understand. I mean, it's like a journey, right? Like, we go on a journey as we read the book, understanding this, like, extremely complicated scenario that happens for me in a country that I've never been to, right? And you're going on your own journey of being there and really understanding the political dynamics between you as a, you know, sort of an American privileged person, you know, which might not be how you understood yourself before you found yourself. So I'm not asking with judgment.
Yeah. No, I know. This is definitely me still having this within my body, you know, that exists. And there was another part of that question that I was going to answer really quick. I forgot.
We have a few more, so it's okay if you're okay for that. So another question from Erin, which is, your prose is so evocatively full of smells and sounds and descriptions. How did you keep your memories of Senegal so fresh in your mind?
I don't know. You know, first of all, I have my favorite dishes. Like, mafé is this meat dish that is tomato-based with peanuts, a peanut sauce that might not sound delicious, but it is. There's this other dish called chou, which is made with millet. And if you eat too much and drink, the millet expands in your stomach and then your stomach hurts. But it's my favorite dish, you know? And I think that, like, food and smell and sound and just this, like, Senegal, that experience is still so visceral for me.
Right.
That
I don't like the movie so much. What do you think it is about Senegal that really just, was it just like the time in your life and where you were and that it happened to be a place that spoke to you? Or is it just something magical about?
I think there's something magical about it. I've bumped into readers who go back every few years or every year with their family. Like, when I finally left Senegal for the first time in over a year and a half, I was on a plane crying. And I was just like, dude, this is so, first of all, kind of corny. Like, I'm leaving Mother Africa, you know? But it was just like, oh God, I'm leaving, you know? I couldn't figure it out. And I
felt that you gelled with.
Yeah.
So a question related to that is, Philip says, as a North American or even a Pacific Northwestern audience, what can we learn from your portrait of Senegal? Do you see any parallels at home?
Yes. One of the things, and it happens during a scene with the Taliban during Ramadan. And you have a traffic altercation and these two drivers get out of their cars and they're really ready to go to blows. And what ends up happening is like sort of a hive of humans, Senegalese people, come onto them and they mediate the situation. And it was just, it's something that happens in Senegal, like it's not even a second thought that whoever is in the vicinity of an altercation, men and women alike will come and mediate the situation. You don't have to call the police. Mm-hmm. And that was just something so massively, like, it's beautiful. And it's a way that, like, society self-runs, sort of self-governs in this kind and empathetic way. Mm-hmm. Because people come and they're like, what they are doing for each of the people who are angry is, I see you. I hear you, you do have a right to be upset. And they calm the people down and then everyone goes on their way. Mm-hmm. Whereas we have this culture here in the US where it's like, either I'm gonna video it or I'm gonna act like I don't see it at all. Mm-hmm. And there's such a fear to see one another, to stand up for other people that if it existed over here, our lives would be richer in a way that that Senegalese people experience.
Right.
You know, yeah.
Yeah. And so we have time for, I think, one to two more. And so Deborah asks, there are many elements of magic realism in your book. I'm wondering what your choices and process looked like in weaving those in. How did you make decisions about when to lean heavily into the stark reality and when to move into these more surreal spaces throughout the story?
So to me, I didn't realize I was writing magic realism because in Senegal, and I think in Africa, and if you kind of like listen to Trevor Noah, like in my family, on my mom's side is from Honduras. Magic in our family exists. Magic within Black communities exists and in Africa. Mm-hmm. And I saw things in Senegal that I probably shouldn't have seen or had been witness to that I was just like, you know, okay. And so there are things sort of that I took from my own life. And then things that I saw while I was in Senegal. And that's sort of how I interwove those pieces together.
Right.
And again, it's all about a balancing act, right? For example, Mustafa, the wealthy boy, he exists because I had some Black American female friends of mine actually take Talibay in and clean them up, bathe them, feed them, and have them watch TV. And I felt like interweaving that just with one family for Ibrahima and Etienne, we give the story a bit of rest from the brutality, you know, that these things do exist, or the French family downtown, they actually existed. Any Talibay that went to their house, they would feed them.
Right.
And so like, you know, interweaving, and I think the magic realism was a part of that. Interweaving that in. And then in some cases, you know, editorially, I was made to do some things. And so magic had to literally come in and make it happen.
Right. And then a good last one from Kalima, which is, what is your favorite scene in the book? And what is your favorite book besides your own?
Okay. So my favorite scene, I would say, is when they go to the lighthouse.
Mm-hmm.
I really like that scene with the lighthouse. Ibrahima is just thinking about, like, if he had just more time, like, what he would do with it.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, he's like, I would be a boy, you know, eat, maybe, you know, but, like, time is really what he comes to understand he needs. And one of my favorite books, I would say, is Maya Angelou's Even the Stars Look Lonesome, I think is the name of the title. When I first moved to New York, so I'm one of those, I'll read a book.
Where are you from?
Boston.
Boston.
Yeah. And I'll reread books. Mm-hmm. And when I moved to New York, I was reading that book of short stories. And I would get on the 6 train to go up to my friend's place in the Bronx that I was staying with, and I would read it. And then I just started reading it over again. And for a long time, like, I just kept the book with me and kept her words with me. Like, they did so much for me at that time. It was just such a transitional time for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of my top ones.
Amazing. Yeah. Well, that is our last question. And this has been an extraordinary chit chat about such a lovely book. And I'm so glad that you did write it. And I know it was a pandemic baby.
Yes.
So that means that it's even more important that you all go pick up this beautiful copy of No Heaven for Good Boys. Again, Elliot Day is hosting it. Seattle Local Library Foundation is also a sponsor here. Yes. Borrow it. Buy it. It's really, really, really important. These debuts come into the world and they like live or die based on whether or not people pick up a copy, not just for themselves, but also for their mamas and their friends and their cousins. So make sure that you get a copy since you're here tonight. And it's been such a pleasure to talk to you. And so thank you so much for having us and for writing this book.
Thank you, Lisa. I'm so indebted to you.
Oh, please. You don't owe me anything. Thank you. I owe you something for the good read.
Thank you.
Oh my goodness, what a wonderful conversation. Thank you both so much. And thank you, Lisa, for reminding people that they can buy the book at Elliott Bay. We put a link in the chat if you want to just do that right now. We have also put a link in the chat to the library, the book in the library's collection. So if you want to borrow it from the library, you can do that there. Lisa, do you have any Pantheon or Shocken books that you'd like to let folks know are coming out?
Goodness! I mean, I was not.
I know, I didn't prepare you for that.
I'm very excited about a book called Their Plant Eyes. Which is a cultural history of blindness, which I think is actually like a really beautiful and important book. It's just out soon. And I'm also really excited about one that's coming up quite soon, but is not out yet, but that you can absolutely pre-order. And that's called Seek You by Kristen Radke, which is a graphic work of nonfiction that explores the idea of loneliness. And as the pandemic fails to go away completely, like the dictionary we never wanted, it was a really good time to think about loneliness still. So those are the two that I think that I would off the cuff with absolutely zero preparation whatsoever, with apologies to anybody who watches this and like, why didn't you say my book?
Fantastic. Awesome. Thank you so much. And thank you for the wonderful conversation tonight. You know, we're grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. We're very grateful to our program partners, Wanawari, which is a beautiful art space, Black run and art space, Black owned art space that exists in our central district to create space for Black artists and community to gather. And they actually are open right now. I went and saw their current exhibit. It's fantastic. So you just have to use hand sanitizer and be metered. But anyway, check it out. And we're grateful to our program partners, Elliott Bay Book Company. And of course, we're grateful to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you next time. Good night, you guys.
Bye.